welcome to Wednesday night. We are in our May Miracles. I'm Pastor Poet, and I'm so excited that you decided to join us. Tonight is going to be a night like no other. God is going to continue to move. We are truly in faith, believing, just as Jesus appeared in the 10 appearances after Passover, after his resurrection, he appeared. We believe that God is going to move in your life. He's going to move in this service tonight. He's going to appear unto you, that you will feel his presence. You will feel him move in your life mightily, and God is going to do extraordinary, infallible things upon your life. We're believing for jobs. We're believing for miracles to happen. Healing will happen. Cancers will be healed. We are so excited and full of faith that God is going to do a mighty move tonight in your life. Let us go into service. Let us give him honor, give him glory, give him praise as we worship the God who we love and who loves us.
Good evening, church, and welcome streaming. Let's stand to our feet and get ready to praise the Lord tonight.
Miracles when you move, such an easy thing for you to do. In your hand, it's moving right now. You are still showing up. The tomb of every Lazarus, in your voice is calling me out. And right now, I know you're able. And my God, come through again. You can do all things. You can do.
You never lost the battle.
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 You never lost
Thank you, Jesus. Is there anybody believing for a miracle tonight? I said, is there anybody believing for a miracle tonight? Thank you, Jesus. I ask for you to move in this place tonight, Lord. I've lived stories that have proved your faithfulness. And I've seen miracles my mind can't comprehend. There is beauty in what I don't understand. Jesus, it's you. Jesus, it's you. I believe the wonder-working God. You're the wonder-working God. All the miracles I've seen, too good to not believe. You're the wonder-working God. And you heal because you love. All the miracles we'll see, you're too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Yeah.
And I can resurrect a man with my own hands. Just a mention of your name can raise the dead.
And all the glory to the only one who can. Jesus is you. Jesus is you.
Let's declare this tonight.
I've seen cancer disappear. I've seen broken bodies healed. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell
Come on,
me
Church,
he
if you're
can't
expecting
do
tonight,
it.
Lift your
I've
voice
seen
up.
Real life resurrection. I've seen mental health restored. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it.
I've seen faith. He's reunited. I see prodigals return. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. I've seen troubled souls delivered. I've seen addicts finally free. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me.
Yes, Lord. The Lord is in this place tonight. I said the Lord is in this place tonight. Church, can we just take this moment? We've all come with so much expectation tonight, expecting to see God move in incredible ways, expecting for miracles to come. So I'm going to ask you to do something right now. I'm going to ask you to take the authority that God has given you, and you start to speak life into your miracles tonight. We're going to speak life into miracles. I don't know what they look like, but I know that God can do it. So I don't care how big it is. I don't care how impossible it looks. You look your miracle in the eye and you say, it is done. Because you know the God that you serve. You know that the God that you serve is greater. You know that the God that you serve has done it over and over and over. And you know that the God that you serve is working all things for good. All things for good. So church, start to speak life tonight. Come on, let's speak life, Lord. We speak life tonight. Yes, we believe, Lord. We believe. No, more we believe. No, there's nothing that my God can do. We say,
no, there's nothing that my God can do.
Even when the doctor said there was no more they could do, I said,
no, there's nothing that my God can do.
Even when I was drowning in death, I said,
no, there's nothing that my God can do. There's nothing that my God can do.
I speak to cancer. I speak to diabetes. I speak to freedom.
No, there's nothing that my God can do.
No, there's nothing, Lord.
No, there's nothing that my God can do. No, there's nothing that my God can do.
I see cancer.
I see cancer disappear. I see broken bodies. Yes, I know that he can do it.
Yes, I know that
yes, he can do it. I see real life resurrection. I see mental health restored. Yes, I know that he can do it. Yes, I know that he can do it. I see families reunite. I see prodigals return. Yes, I know.
Believe, and I have seen it. I see. saw it in my own life just yesterday. So God is good. Family, God is good. So he is too good to not believe. So we're going to believe it. And as we do, we're going to declare 3 John 2 together. And we're going to do it with a faith that we've never had before. So declare it loud together with me. Beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health just as thou. Soul prospers. Hallelujah. Dear Father, we just thank you. We thank you that you are a good Father. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that your love knows no bounds. And Father God, I thank you that we can believe you for everything that our heart desires, that everything that we need, Father. And Lord Jesus, I pray that you would just pour upon your children, upon each one of us, your sons and daughters, a fresh touch, a fresh believing, Lord God, a fresh anointing of just your prosperity, of your provision, of your wisdom, of your favor, of your open doors, oh God. I just pray, Lord God, that you would just help us to just know and declare with our mouth, even before we see it, that it is done. The doors are open. The job is ours. The provision is here. The finances are here. The house that we're believing for is ours. And Lord Jesus, we thank you that we can stand in faith, knowing that you love us, knowing that you are good. And we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. I don't know how to tell you this, but I'm glad I'm part of the greatest church this side of heaven. Come on. Amen. Right, Karen and George? Amen. Now, if you need to see the miraculous, believe God for the ridiculous. Let me pray for you. Father, I thank you for these precious Wednesday night parishioners. God, I'm asking you to touch every ailing, sick body. Heal every heart. Heal every blood system. Let everything that's not right be right now in Jesus' name. We command cancer to go in Jesus' name. You have no right, no privilege, and no authority in this house. We thank you, Jesus. You're still on the throne. What you did yesterday, you're going to do today. None of us are leaving the same as we came. In Jesus' name, can I get one good amen?
Amen, amen. Lord, we just thank you for this atmosphere of faith, oh Lord. Lord, we come in an atmosphere believing in you, oh Father. And it says, even as our soul prospereth, oh Lord. Lord, so I come right now, we pray, oh Lord. We pray, oh Lord, for our emotions, oh Lord, our wills, oh Lord, oh Father God. Lord, oh Father, let your spirit move in, oh Lord. Lord, in faith, oh Lord, oh Father, we cancel out fear, oh Lord. Lord, and we move in a dimension, oh Lord, of the revelation of who you called us to be. Lord, that they are children, children of the Most High God, oh Lord. Lord, that they are a royal priesthood. Lord, oh Father, so we come in an agreement, oh Father, that their souls are well. Lord, that their spirit, oh Lord, intertwine with your spirit, oh Lord. And they will go forth, oh Lord, and do the miraculous, oh Lord. Miraculous things will happen upon their lives, oh Lord. In the spirit of belief today, oh Father. Lord, that you're moving on their behalf, oh Lord. Lord, that their souls are prospering. Lord, we bind, oh Lord, depression. Lord, we bind, oh Lord, any evil thoughts, oh Lord, and we subject our minds unto your will, Lord. And when your will is done, oh Lord, that you move and your kingdom shall come over your children's life. On this day, oh Father, we speak success and victory, Lord, because we know that you can do it. In Jesus' mighty name, we say amen, and we know that you can do it. We know that you can do it, oh Lord. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
All the miracles I see, you're too good to not believe. You're the wonder-working God, and you heal because you love. All the miracles I see, you're too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. Too good to not believe. too good to not believe.
Yeah. Everyone that is believing for a better job, all of your applications, as they continue to sing this song, come quickly to the front. Sing.
Yes, I know they can't do it.
I've seen cancer disappear. I've seen broken bodies heal. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. I've seen friends resurrected. I've seen mental health restored. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. I've seen families reunited. I've seen prodigals return. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. I've seen troubled souls delivered. I've seen addicts finally free. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. And we'll see cities in revival as salvation flood the streets. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Don't you tell me he can't do it. We'll see glory fill the nations like the world has never seen. Don't you tell me he can't do it. Cause I know that he can't do it.
Toward all of these, looking for a better job, looking for increase in their life. And everyone that, Pastor, if you just come up and let's hold these up. Now, all of you that have got great jobs, got plenty of money, that's great. These are people who really want to increase in life. How many? So I want all of us to believe that every name, doors are open, favor will come upon them. It is God's will that they prosper. So everybody say, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Every name.
Every name.
Every application.
Every application.
Let increase.
Let increase.
Let prosperity.
Let prosperity.
Come upon.
Come upon.
All of these applicants.
All of these applicants.
And in the name of Jesus.
And in the name of Jesus.
May great favor,
may great favor
be upon your life.
Be upon your lives.
A more than enough. To meet all of your needs. In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Turn to somebody and say, prosperity is on you, and you may prosperity be seated. Is on. Thank you. What a great song. That was a great song, guys. Great song. Watch this, everybody. You may be seated. Great.
This Saturday, May 21st at 9 a.m., we will be partnering for the second year in a row with World Vision's Global 6K. For those of you who were with us last year, you know this is such an incredible community event. Every registration that we have goes to support a child in a developing country, bringing fresh, clean, sustainable water and resources to that child. For those of you who were with us last year, it is such an incredible event. So you can go to our website, you can also go to our app, and right on the bottom, you'll see Global 6K. Go ahead and register. For every registration, you get a child that you'll be sponsoring. This year, I will be sponsoring the country of Uganda. So this is my little one that I'll be running for. World Vision will also send you a finisher medal and a t-shirt. You can also give a donation. And for those of you who want to participate on a different level, we are also looking for volunteers. So you can come and be a part and sign up right after service in the lobby. So make sure to go to our website, go to our app today, and register. I'll be in the lobby all weekend, and I can't wait to tell you more about our World Vision Global 6K.
I'm under the blood. Every sin I ever did was under the blood. The devil is a liar. The Lord has made me free. I'm trying to say there's a level of freedom that goes beyond just going to church on a Sunday morning. There is a freedom that comes that you can't wait to get to God's house. You can't wait to sing the songs that you can't wait to worship your God.
Hey, everybody, I'm comedian Brett.
What? You're too close. They can't see. Wait, there.
Hey, I'm Brett Walko. No, it's still too close.
Hey, everybody, I'm comedian Brett Walko, and I'm coming to you. Well, not to you, not to your house. That'd be weird if I knocked on your door like, hey, I'm here to do some comedy. What's for dinner?
No, I'm coming to the Operation Care fundraiser dinner extravaganza.
Yeah, it's an extravaganza,
and I'm going to come do some comedy for you. We're going to have a great time, and we're going to raise a lot of money for Operation Care. So, I better see you there, Saturday, June 4th.
Woohoo!
Like having a good comedian, and it's going to be at Operation Care. Let me get a few things out, and then I want to, we want miracles to happen. Next Wednesday, Perry Stone. Everybody say Perry Stone. And for you that have seen him on television, national television, he'll be here next week, and that will be great. Let's talk about this run. You see that Winter is talking about the run. This is, we are partnering with World Vision, and this is for water. This is for water in parts of the world. Now join me, I'm going to run. Boy, my legs are sore now because I've been building up for this run. 6K, 6K, so we're gonna do it right here. We're gonna do it right here on this campus. We're going to run on the park behind us. It's gonna be grand and great. If you don't wanna run, you can walk. If you don't want to walk or run, tonight before you leave, sponsor. Go back there and sponsor a child, and I'll run for you for that child and for water for this child. And all of this money goes to World Vision, and it will not pass through us. It'll go straight to World Vision. They will respond to you. They will tell you exactly what's going on. Let's run for water. Let's run for children. Let's run for those that don't have running water. We don't have the basis. We don't have the money to drill wells, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. But we're joining in with a national group of people from city after city so that we can be a part of digging wells or World Vision digging wells, and they will be able to help all of these children. You'll get a picture of the child. You will get a picture of the child in which that water will go to. No doubt you will get a letter from that child. That child somewhere in the world. What a letter. Opening up your mailbox. There, that child from somewhere in the world through World Vision tells you thank you. Go in the lobby after church and sign up or come at 9 o'clock. We're going to have a lot of fun. I'm going to be there. And we're going to run, cheer us on, and let us do something that will change the world. And everybody say amen. Amen. Let me also tell you about Memorial Day prayer. How many knows we can't live without Memorial Day prayer? It has always changed the world. This year, India will join us. Also, China will join us. They will join us live in our prayer meeting, 6 to 7 o'clock Memorial Day. That's very, very important. Also, I want to say to all interns, if you are wanting to intern, sign up, get ready, because intern, I think, starts the second week of June, and that's all young people that want to intern. Now, what do we do when we intern? Intern, we learn about lights, we learn about sound, we learn about all kinds of things that our leaders teach the interns. And then on July 31st, the last Saturday of July, we do Hotel Hallelujah. So the interns help us build the sets, and as we go forward to do HH, it's going to be incredible. Interns, that means if you graduated from college, going to college, graduated from high school, you're eligible for an intern. Come, it's fun. I think it's 3 days, 4 days a week. I'm here, we're all here, and we just do things together that is so exciting. And it will be wonderful. It'll be wonderful that you be and come and be a part of intern. You get a certificate, and we'll have a blast. There's a lot of things to do, and I love our interns. We had nearly 50 last year. Let's raise it and have a great time with interns doing business for God. On June 8th, everybody say June 8th. That's Wednesday night. That starts Summer Sizzle. Summer Sizzle. This year is going to be absolutely phenomenal. One of the most incredible things that is going to happen this year in our series for 7 weeks in Summer Sizzle is a journey through the tabernacle. Recently, Dr. Terry Harmon was approached by a group that built the tabernacle that's in the Bible. And let me just say this. When you understand the tabernacle, you will understand heaven, revelations, most of the Bible, because God drew the architect in Moses' mind, the tabernacle, where the holies of holies, where the holy place is. It's laid out like a cross. It helps you to understand the prophecies. The book of Revelation is laid out like a tabernacle. You will understand heaven better when you study the tabernacle. And when you see how God told Moses to build the tabernacle. Well, recently, a 90-some-year-old man from Dallas for 25 years had traveled with the real, and I say the real, to the inch tabernacle. The holy place is 15 foot high, 15 foot wide, and it is 40 foot long. Around it is the fence, outside is the altar and the laver. When you learn about it, it's so exciting. So in the approach of this man in Dallas, who had this ministry for 20-some years, contacted Terry Harmon, and he'll be able to tell you better the testimony. But he came to me, we partnered with it. They gave us the tabernacle. The tabernacle, a museum of tabernacle. On the east side of the building, it is in that semi-trailer tractor. Thank you, Herman Jackson, who drove down there with Walter's truck, picked up the semi-trailer, and packed in there is the tabernacle. Now, what is exciting, I don't know where I'm going to put it. I think I'll put it on the east side of the building here. And on Wednesday nights, if you come to the teaching of the tabernacle, you will be given a free ticket to go through the tabernacle, 40 feet by 15 feet by 15 feet high, the exact dimension that God gave to Moses, and it's brass on the inside. All of the furniture will be on the inside. You will understand Christianity a lot better with the tabernacle. We're going to open it up to the Jewish community. Also, we're going to open it up to the religious community. We also are hiring a security company in which it will be guarded for 24 hours a day. Nobody will be able to go in that unless you have the permission to go into the Holies of Holies. This is a spectacular, incredible piece of art in which now we possess. It's in that trailer. We're going to have to put it together. I mean, it's going to be magnificent. We've never had anything like this. I've taught the tabernacle many years ago and love to teach it. You will love it. You will love every Wednesday night, every aspect. If you come on Wednesday night, you'll be given a free ticket, and you will be given reservations right after the service, whether you come the first Wednesday night, second Wednesday night, as far as the order in which you can go. Probably only like 100 can go through at a time, and then it will take a few minutes. It is like a museum, and there'll be the high priest there. Everything will be in order. Now, remember, guys, that the tabernacle is, heaven is laid out exactly like the tabernacle. The book of Revelation is laid out like the tabernacle. You'll probably go so advanced. Everybody say advanced. You'll probably go so advanced in biblical knowledge with this incredible, incredible museum and the piece of art that we don't quite know if anybody in the world, the United States, has got this museum of this masterpiece to the inch that God was the architect of and gave to Moses. And the only thing we probably won't be able to put everything up is, and that is the fence. The fence, of course, is much wider. It's 120. God required a fence around all of that, but we'll put the barricades on it. But one of the most important things is the 40-foot by 15-foot wide by 15-foot high, the holy place, and then the holies of holies. You will get to go for the first time behind the veil to see what it was like for nearly 3,500 years when no one could go into the Ark of the Covenant. You will see the layout. You will see what it means. Let me just give you just a taste. The colors of the veil are red, white, and purple, and blue. That was the veil colors, the colors of that was in the tabernacle. Those are four colors. Those are God's four colors. They all mean something. But it's interesting that those four colors represent the four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The four heads on the cherubim, the eagle, the lion, and the Son of Man, and the bullock. Each color represents something about heaven, represents something about now. There's nobody going to get to have the experience like all of us and our friends and neighbors. The tabernacle starts June 8th, and then summer sizzle and all of the stuff we do for the children. And let me tell you, we make church exciting. It's not boring. It's one of the most exciting places you can go to. Perception and the miracles. Perception. Let me read to you from the book of Acts. While we sit here and be ministered to, there's a miracle going to happen, not to everybody, but to anybody that has faith to believe. So we could talk about it, or let's do it. We could talk about it, or we can do it. Do what? Believe for our miracle. Now, I do not know. In a moment, I'm going to, Charisse is here, I think, and friend, and I will tell you testimonial-wise miracles to help your faith. Tonight, next week, is our emphasis on miracles. Thank you for all of you. I didn't, when I saw you, I didn't have to pray for 5 inches of snow tonight. So thank you for being nice to be kind and to be obedient, because this is important to God. God wants you to experience healings, miracles. God is up for this. God is anxious for this. This is not a hard thing. So let me read to you Apostle Paul. He's in a city. They don't know anything. They don't have a church yet. And he's establishing church. These are all people that don't know anything about the gospel. They don't know anything about miracles. They just don't know anything about the gospel. So we read in the 7th verse. Maybe we start there. And there they preached the gospel. This is Apostle Paul and also Barnabas. I'd like for everybody to say gospel. Everybody say gospel. There they preached gospel. In the first part of the book of Acts 1 through 6, you'll see the city and Lystra and the Derbe cities and Lycaonia. These were the cities and the regions that they were in. There sat a certain man in Lystra. This was a city. He was important in his feet, being crippled from his mother's womb, who had never walked. He never walked. Have a wheelchair here. He had never, ever walked, okay? The same heard Paul speak. Now, that's important. He heard him speak. What was Paul speaking? What was he speaking? What was he speaking? He was speaking and preaching the gospel. The gospel. The gospel. So while Paul was speaking, the Bible said, who steadfastly beholded him. Now watch, this is very important. I think this is one of the greatest revelations here. Paul perceiving this man who has never walked before, Paul is perceiving that he had faith to be healed. Okay? Now I'm going to say this to everybody that's here and watching me. Can I look at you individually and can I perceive, I believe you're going to get a miracle? How do I get to that place? When two agree, Bible says it shall be done. If you're sitting here tonight and saying, I'm skeptical, I'm waiting, I don't know, if God wants to, all of those adjectives of support in which we are wondering if God is going to do us a miracle. In this case, man had never walked before, not much church. There was no church in Lystra. Paul was establishing that. These were all heathen people. Paul was preaching the gospel. What's in the gospel? What was he preaching? What about the gospel? What is the gospel? And we'll refer to that in just a moment. And then Paul, all of a sudden, while he was preaching the gospel, looked over at a man who had never walked before. The man was hearing talking about the gospel. Paul then perceived. Now, there are, for you that were here last week, we talked about the gifts of the Spirit. You saw me have a saw here. You saw me talk about the power gifts, you know, the gift of knowledge, the gift of discernment, the gift of faith, the gift of miracles, the gift of healings. These are power gifts in which we can earnestly covet, as the Bible has declared. Now, Paul is perceiving. He didn't have a word of knowledge. He didn't say he had a word of knowledge, which is one of the power gifts, which will operate in the next few minutes. I'll ask the Lord. You'll ask the Lord. Lord, what is it that you want to do here? What is it, God? What do you want to do? And the Holy Spirit will start moving in the next few minutes. And maybe God will speak and I'll hear something or I'll sense something and call it out. And people will come and say, that's what I need. That's a gift of knowledge. Or there's the discerning of spirits. You can just sense people are going through stuff in their life and you discern there's a warfare going on, whether it's through families, individual, somebody struggling, a crushing spirit, whatever. We may discern that. That's the gifts of the Spirit. The gift of wisdom. The gift of wisdom is the gift comes upon you. All of a sudden, God gives you a piece of revelation to answer which needs to be answered, and it is the gift of wisdom, something you don't learn in school, something you don't learn anywhere. It just, how did you know that answer? And you say, well, I just, and it could be the operation of the gift of wisdom. Anybody that is in business, anybody that is in making decisions, whether it be a school teacher, a lawyer, whether it be a nurse, whether it be a doctor, whether it be whatever you're doing, there will be moments in your life you will be caught in a situation that you will say, man, I need wisdom right now. Here's a patient dying with a heart attack. I'm a heart specialist. A doctor says, I'm a heart specialist. The gift of wisdom. The gift of wisdom starts operating and he starts doing things he would not normally do because of the gift of wisdom. And all believers, not just anybody, but all believers have the right to say, I need the gift of wisdom and a supernatural wisdom that you didn't have the knowledge of it before. Boom, you did it, and people ask you, how did you know that? How did you know that? And you just said, I don't know, I just, the gift of wisdom. The gift of wisdom. So that can operate, that could change your whole life. One answer to one question could change the rest of your life. One idea, one situation could turn a whole situation around. And so, but Paul is in a position, he's not reached any of these power gifts. He's perceiving, which means that Paul is in the realm of what I would call the soulish realm, which is the emotional level of you can pretty well perceive. Every one of us can pretty well perceive. especially if we walk in to three or four people that are in a circle and we walk up and we just perceive, ooh, they just been talking about me. Ah, something going on here. You don't have to have the gift of wisdom, the gift of discernment. You don't have to have the gift of knowledge. You've got a perception. Come on, talk to me now. You men that are married, that have been married over 2 weeks, you can walk in knowing. You don't have to have the gift of knowledge to know she's, something's not right here. And you're wondering if she knows about whatever, whatever, whatever. Our children will walk in with their parents in the room. Even children will perceive something right here. Oh, I hope I didn't get caught. Oh, what did I do? What, et cetera. Or parents perceive. So in this is not a power gift. This is just in humanity, relating with humanity, that all of us have the ability. We pretty well can perceive things in life. Paul used not the gift, but he perceived. He sensed. He looked at this crippled man. And he perceived, which, when you look up the word perceive, it means that you perceive, they believe, they something you know positively in your perceiver. And in that, the Bible says that Paul looked at him, shouted out to him, "Stand up!" You can sit there and wait and keep waiting and keep waiting. But if it is perceived, there's something going on within you. All of a sudden, the faith of someone else, the faith of someone else, shouts out to you. The man did not say, "Are you looking at me, Paul? I believe. Can I stand up now?" He didn't do that. Paul perceived. Why don't you exercise that somebody else sitting next to you, beside you, behind you, in front of you, or in this building might perceive that a miracle will happen to you? And will tell you it's going to happen tomorrow morning at 9 o'clock. And why did you say that? Why did you say that? Because you can pretty well, in the natural, perceive somebody sitting on the edge, listening intently. And you don't even need spiritual to know this person's already. I know you're sitting there like this. I'll just wait and see. You're gonna leave just like you came. Wait and see. Anybody that's ever gone into a bank to get a loan, if you walk in, I doubt if I get it. I know the guy's going to turn me down. Probably because I have bad credit. Well, first of all, what are you going into the bank for? You've already made the decision, and the banker's going to see the perception of, there are already doubters. I don't want to get them on our roll because they probably can't pay the bill anyway. But you walk in with expectancy. You have the power to change the atmosphere. Quit being the thermostat. the thermostat of your life. I'm just going to set it on this, and if it happens, it happens or not. Change the atmosphere until you make the thermostat kick into gear. You have the power to sit on ready to say, I believe. Paul then says, and Paul said with a loud voice, I perceive you can be healed. Now, one thing that will kill the perceiver, in this case, Paul, or a perceiver, say, myself as pastor, or even you as believers to your children, to one another, to a brother, praying for somebody, or just in general, you can kill the perceiver by filling him with too much information. Wait a minute. Pastor, before a miracle's going to happen to me, do you know what I'm going through? Kill the perceiver. Get him as negative as you are, and nothing's going to happen. Paul didn't even know that he was never walked. Paul never knew he had been born. It was later that he found out. All Paul could see is that he could perceive, this guy's on ready. I need to take a break from my preaching and say, stand up on your feet. Just a minute, Paul. I've never walked. I was born this way. They carried me to the meeting today. I know I'm attentive and I really believe, but I just want to tell you how impossible it is for you to say that. Too much information. I'm not interested in what you've been through and what. That's too much information. Just let me perceive. Or let somebody get an agreement to perceive for you until you start speaking things that are not as though they were. Are you getting this? Sit there. It should be in your spirit, man, right now. It should be. I'm not leaving here in the next few minutes. Something's going to happen. Nothing has never happened to me in church or never happened to me in spiritual atmosphere unless I went in there having the same spirit as David said. I was glad when they said unto me, we're going to church on Wednesday night. And if your glad has been stolen from you from your busyness and your headaches and from your arguments and from your busy schedules, you're probably going to struggle with that because God demands that when you enter into his sanctuary, that you must enter in with, I'm so thankful I'm here tonight. My God, this is the greatest place in all of. Don't you bring that spirit of the club in here, waiting on who's the favorite dancer and who's the favorite singer. This is not a club. This is not about how we judge. This is about God is in the house. And what matters is when I walk in, I'm not going to walk out the same way I walked in. I've come tonight. I am so thankful that I am in the house. Help me now. Enter into his gates with. How thankful are you? How thankful are you? How thankful are you? Can you be thankful for 30 seconds? I'm going to count it off. 30, 29, 27, 26, 25, 24, 23, 22, 21, 20, 19, 18, 17, 16, 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Good, you may be seated. Now, keep that level. Because this is gospel or good news. And believing in the impossible is what God is looking for. He is looking for people who want to do impossible things. Only impossible things can happen for what I need in life. Yes. And God has been waiting all day for you. Because the Bible said when two or three are gathered in his name, he'll be in the midst of them. So he said, forsake not the assemblies of yourself. You cannot believe how God was so excited, because he committed himself to say, if we get two or three together and a bunch of people get together, I'm going to be there. Well, what are you going to do while you're there, God? Oh, while I'm there, I'm going to be looking for somebody that believes for the impossible. That's what he's going to do. Impossible. Possible. I've often said it. One word. One phone call. One letter. One email. One person, one door opening, you're all one away. You're not in line, you're one away. I'm one away from being a multimillionaire. I'm broke today, but I'm one away. I'm a dollar for the next dollar, for the next dollar, and for the next dollar, and then for the next dollar, but I first got to get the first one to get the next one. You're one away. You're one away from a doctor looking at you saying, I don't know what happened, but whatever happened, you can go home. I'll see you 3 months from now. Ain't nothing wrong with you. You're just one doctor away from him telling you how healed you are. One interview away. Some of you are going to walk into an interview and they're not even going to like you. They don't like your shoes. They don't like you. They don't like your hair. They don't even like you. And God's going to do a brain surgery on them while you're there, and they're going to end up liking you by the fourth paragraph and saying, man, we don't have to go any farther in this interview. You're hired. I wasn't going to hire you when I watched you walk in, but I'm going to hire you now. Okay? Perceiving. I perceive. We should all be very conscious, especially in the negative society we live in, that when somebody says to you, you're going to do good, You should clasp those words. Do you know the power of somebody telling you you're going to be a champion? You're going to be rich. You're going to be prosperous. Girl, there's a man coming for you, honey. And he's not a playboy. He'll make your bed, baby. I'm talking about making the bed. Don't confuse him. You should understand that when someone talks to you or says to you, be blessed, God's going to heal you. Get ready for a miracle. Those words are more valuable than gold. To speak. Parents speaking over their children. Speaking over your family. I love to be around people. I love to perceive people. You're going to be great. This is going to be wonderful. This is going to be incredible. You're going to be phenomenal. Most people look at you and say, you're weird. You're weird. What are you trying to prove? You're a politician. You just want to make me to feel good. Well, what do you want me to say? You ugly, fat thing. You will be bankrupt 6 months. Your nose is crooked. Your ears are too big. You'll never make it. It sounds better. Man, good things are going to happen to you. I perceive God is up to something great. I have the power, the Bible says, I can prophesy. Romans says, you have the power to prophesy according to your faith. In other words, you have the right as a believer. You can speak things. You have the right. It don't matter what the devil thinks or what religion thinks or what the next door neighbor thinks. You have the right to say, I'm telling you, something good is going to happen to you. You have the right to speak it. You have the right to perceive it. You have the right. Right? And we think it's sales talk. Pastor, you're a used car salesman. That's what used car salesmen do. What do they do? What is used car? Where did that come from? You sound like a used car salesman. Where'd that come from? I got to thinking about that. Used car salesman. Meaning that if I act with my charisma, with excitement, something good's going to happen. You are a used car salesman. And then I got to thinking, to be a good used car salesman? You got to convince this person that this used car is incredible. Until whether you believe it or not, sign the paper, 8% interest, don't matter, drive it off. You got to be good to sell a used car. You walk up to the used car, boy, this is beautiful. Oh, you don't want this car. It's got 46,000 miles on it. You should see the tires. And you want me to raise the hood? Look at the engine. Let me tell you, do you have any new cars? No, we only got used cars. What are you going to say about the next one? I'll tell you the truth about the next one, too. Tell you about that guy. He still got the same cars he had 2 years ago on the lot and hadn't moved to one. He doesn't believe in this product. He can't convince you of anything. You are sold, all of you. The clothes you have on your body. So nobody made me buy this. No, they didn't. You saw it on somebody else. You saw it in a picture. You saw it in a picture. A window. Have you been in the store? I've been in the store. Like something so much, turn to the person and say, you know, I really like that. What do you think? I really like that. What do you? And it's a mannequin standing there. Excuse me. So faith that God has given you is established in the principles of the gospel, and faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And we learned, Phil Munsey, just a few weeks ago, I love this, I've been using it, I like it, and that is, he says, the opposite of faith is sight. And the Bible says we don't walk by sight, we walk by faith. Come on, everybody help me. We walk by faith. That means that we believe for things we cannot see, and we must thank God in advance of what we cannot feel, touch, and see. This is what pleases God. Joe, can you get Hebrews 11:6? This is what pleases God. This is so ridiculous to the human mind that you would actually say, I'm going to get a house, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. This, here's what God says. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. You can't please God unless you're talking about stuff you can't see. I'm going to repeat that statement again. You can't please God unless you're talking and believing things you haven't seen. For instance, how many's going to heaven? That's great. Thank God, no altar calls tonight. It looks like everybody's safe. Have you ever seen heaven? Where is it? Where is it? Is it there? There? We read of up, so we think up. We think of down, hell. You're going to heaven. You haven't seen it. You haven't seen it. Well, I read about it. You still haven't seen it. You just read about it. Streets of gold, and we can go on and on and on. God saves people who believe what they cannot see, but know it's going to happen in their life. That is faith. All of you have been on a road to get to this church tonight. Some of you came from the highway, some of the back roads, but most of you on your way here, where it was the last mile stretch or the last 3 miles or 4 miles, it is crazy what we did. 40 miles an hour, right up on the yellow line with another vehicle at 40 miles an hour this far apart. Whoosh! Number one, you have faith in the yellow lines. You have faith that that red light will stop before they smash and kill you. Then why don't you have faith? Okay.
Sharice, where are you here? Sharice, where are you? Sharice, I know you can. Sharice, you here? Where are you at? Bring your friend up. Now, Sharice is a woman of faith. She's been in this church many, many years. She always tells me, she could say it for herself. Come on up, sis, both of you. She always tells me, when you say there's going to be miracles, I believe it. Yeah. Now, what do you want me to tell Sharice? Now, Sharice, you should believe that some of the time. When you get in a good mood, and she says, this is the truth, because I perceived, not just her, but to all of you, I perceive in the month of May there's going to be miracles. I perceive that. I'm not asking the details, because if I asked your details, I wouldn't perceive. In fact, I would go into intercession. Oh, God, they need help. Instead of perceiving, there's a miracle coming to you. So let me say this for you, say what you're going to say. The reason why I usually don't counsel people, people always want to talk to me. I got to see the pastor. And I always divert them to the other pastors. Why? Because if you tell me your problem, I then preach about the problem, not even thinking about you. You think I'm talking about you. Not only that, but that if I say God's going to do a miracle in your marriage, not even thinking about you, but perceiving that God's going to heal a marriage, you sit there and say, well, he knows because I told him, my husband, he did dot, 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 dot. And she immediately says, and I'm hypothetically saying this, but she's saying in her mind, he knows, he's talking about me, that ain't going to happen. Too much information. It's better for me to not know. It's better. It's better. There's some things I do know, but it's better. So that I can activate. Paul did not know, he did not know this crippled man in Lystra. He just perceived. You could be healed. Miracle. Stand on your feet. And the Bible said he stood up on his feet. I would rather be in the position to speak that a miracle is going to happen and believe that it is going to happen, and you connect with your faith. It's like jumper cables connecting, and it's activated. You want a pastor. You want a leader. You want someone that speaks those things over you. So we talked about this. She's a great leader. Sharice is a very good leader. Sharice is a great caretaker. I can say a lot of things about her. She's a great community leader. She's always involved in stuff in the community. So, and she had a miracle happen to her. So, because you told me, you said, Pastor, miracles are going to happen. I believed it. I perceived. Okay? So let's see what the miracle is. Now, before she says it, please do not get jealous. Don't be envious. Don't call her a smart aleck. Don't say, who does she think she is? Enjoy it. Because God is no respecter of person. What he's done for her, he can do for everybody. We got two here because she told me about your miracle. We're going to hear about that.
Before I get started, can we all give Pastor a round of applause? And that's for preaching miracles in the month of May. I am the founder and chairman of the board of the Seer Foundation, and what we do is empower and teach students how to be innovators and entrepreneurs. And last week, I received a donation to provide additional scholarships for our students.
And you were believing for a miracle, right?
I was believing for a miracle.
Okay, that's.
And yeah. The miracle happened last week. I received a check for $50,000. Wait, Pastor, I'm going to share.
I'd like to have that happen to me, eh?
And I just wanted to share with you, in addition to the program that we're teaching our students, they also are producing their own television show. And I just want to say thanks to Jay and Adam for helping to train. They're awesome and amazing. And they trained them last year to be featured on Good Morning America, GMA3. And special thanks to Mark Spencer. But the donation came from Hard Rock Casino, Matt Schufert, and our partner with the City of Gary, Mayor Jerome Prince. And we just thank you so much. And tomorrow, our students are going to be interviewing Monique Rodriguez of Mayel Organics. So I just wanted to say thank you.
Hey, it don't matter where the money comes from. Just give it. So tell us, this is so cute about, because she's been a faithful member too. I'd really like for you, you told me about, this is so great. You got to tell her.
Yes.
You got to tell her about what happened here.
So I work for an investment company. It's called Community Investment of Indiana. And we were blessed. Our company was selected by Lake County Economic Development. And they gave our business for us to provide checks for 100 businesses that were affected by COVID, a $5,000 check. And we had the entire year to do that. And we had a few more dollars left last week, so I started reaching out to some people. And I have met Kelly at an event. And I said, Kelly, if you send your paperwork in, I'm going to see if we can be able to help you. And I'm going to let Kelly tell the rest.
Yes. Charisse is my one away, because we didn't know each other. We are members of the church, and the Lord connected us. I got a phone call.
You both come to the same church.
Yes.
And didn't know each other.
Yes.
That's
yes.
Cool.
And I received my May miracle. This is my tithes. I'm
oh,
giving
really?
This to you. Yes. You have to
Amen.
Pay God his money first so you can continue to be blessed.
Well, there you go. That's,
and I just want to say thank you. Yes.
Good.
The Lord connected us. I knew my miracle was coming. I didn't know how, when, where. But it came.
Come on. That's right.
Thank you.
That is.
And, oh, Pastor, I would like for you to come and pray over my business. I have a salon in Crown Point. I've been open for 4 years. I would like for you to come and anoint it, pray over it, okay? Whenever you can.
If that happens, you'll be the busiest beauty shop in the... Come on, give them a great big hand for the miracle.
Thank you, God.
We heard about Rick Newell's miracle last week. We heard, and there's so many cards that we're getting in. Today, I've been talking about our miracle, but the fact is that today was almost finalized. It's pretty amazing, folks, that between Passover and Pentecost, and I'm trying to encourage you, that he visits us, and there are more miracles, more things that happen in this time period. And I want to really encourage you. I know positively, turn your belief and with all of your faith, believe it's going to happen. He's going to visit you. He's coming to visit you wherever you might have. And in the 10 visits that Jesus came after he arose for 50 days, all 10 did not hardly recognize him. You will not recognize at first it's of God. You must get your eyes open. You must believe. And one of the signs in which you know something's going on is you go through weird stuff. I have to. You must learn this from the gospel's sake. Paul said, "I learned to rejoice in my infirmities." He loved the fact that something negative would happen to him, because he knew God was up to something positive. Anybody in this vast auditorium and watching me, just stuff that, oh my God, just drives you crazy, just going through stuff. Just came out of nowhere. Stand up if you're one of those people. Just stand up. Just out of nowhere. That's all of you. Sit back down. That's everybody. That's all of you. Please listen to this in these moments in which I'm about to release, want to release, because I perceive. Please remember that people do not believe, a lot of people do not believe in demons. But there are demons. And as a believer, and let me help you, because we think, if we're not, and it's the devil that lies to us, that we are not good enough to receive from God special miracles, gifts, healings, whatever, because we recollect of something we should not have done. Whether it was a year ago, yesterday, or whatever. Okay? I'm gonna excite you. I'm gonna blow your mind scripturally. Faith has the ability, believing God has the ability to cover you with imputed righteousness. Now, imputed means, the Bible says that because Abraham believed, it was accredited for him for righteousness. Faith puts you in the position of righteousness. You know what righteousness means? Right standing before God. Let's do it this way. When all of you got saved, you were a sinner. I was a sinner. There was stuff we were ashamed of. But you literally believed God. And God put you in a position through your faith of right standing. And then, when he put you in that position, he saved you. When you are believing God, quit beating yourself up. If you believe, faith in God, you please God, he automatically slide you into right standing. He'll require of you to say, God, forgive me, etc. But he's not worried about that right now. He's going to put you in the right place where the devil can't get to you until he fixes what you have believed God for. Okay? And this is where religion comes in and says, you got to be good, you got to. If that was the case, we've all messed. We will never make it. But faith pleases God that God accounts it for righteousness' sake. That's what imputed righteousness means. It's like giving somebody a credit card, say, go spend all you want, I'll pay the bill. And I want to say something here that will help all of us. Quit. Stop it. Quit talking about things you might know that are bad on other people. Or quit saying stuff about what you've heard. Learn. Discipline. If you can't say something good, then it's not worth it coming out of your mouth. Everybody say, I bless you. Before I pray, and I'm going to release something on you, because this wheelchair and what I'm about to do in the next few moments, Stinson, if you'll play with me, I'm going to release something on all of you. And I believe that your faith, because I perceive everybody here, I could tell in the worship tonight, that was a new song. That, by the way, that was a great song. That was a great song. I love that song. New song. And but I could tell everybody in here had come full of expectancy. Come full of expectancy. Thank you, Jesus. And every one of you, God on purpose made sure you got here tonight. He made sure. And God has something he's going to do for you that it's impossible with men or even you. God is going to release an impossible with men miracle upon every. If you, everybody say, everybody just say these words. I'm waiting. Say, I'm ready. So let us quickly, but with great desire, let us take our Wednesday night offering just reverently. And the singers will come and just, we don't want to disturb the Holy Spirit about what he's doing. So the ushers, if you'll take your phones out for you that are, you give with your phone, just do it reverently. And for you, ushers, start passing. And you have an envelope, surely it was passed out to you. Raise your hand. And let's just give reverently before this is released upon you. Our Wednesday night, an offering's a type of worship. And it is with cheerfulness that we That we give. Ushers, you just start going with and you in the balcony, all of you that's got your phones, go on. You know what to do. You're very mature in this. And anyone else, as we begin, and I got tithing in my hand here, and it's an offering. Wow. My offering is important. So the ushers, as we go forth right now, thank you, Lord. Just give. That's it. Just pass the container. Thank you, Jesus. Everybody say, thank you, Jesus. Do it in a worshiping. Just a worshiping. Sometimes we, let's let the offering. Yeah, thank you so much. Thank you. You're giving by phones right now. That's a that must really turn God on, how you've taken technology and you're giving. That must really move God, how God trusts you with that technology. That must really move God. And how that we give our offerings, and for some it's tithing. And all of you on Wednesday night, you are so precious. And all of you that are watching, you're so precious to give. If you want to curb the inflation in your life, give to God. Give to God. If you want insurance for the devourer not to destroy your children, your house, your goods, or your money, give to God. God says, I will rebuke the devourer. He is a great insurance man, a great insurance God. Before I release this upon you, here we're going to come. Everybody's given. There's a balcony given. Great, great look up on the balcony. Hey, balcony, you look great up there. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Here, Pastor Poe. Everybody giving? Everybody giving? Balcony. Balcony's given. They're coming. And everybody say, oh God.
Oh God.
I give.
I give.
I worship.
I worship.
In my giving.
In my giving.
This is yours, God.
This is yours, God.
Oh, the phones are going up. That's a great habit. Everybody's giving by phone. Just lift it up, because many people, when they see the bucket pass, say, you didn't give. So lift your phone up to let people know you've given. That's good. Not ashamed. You're in the balcony. Way to go. And everybody say, oh God.
Oh God.
I receive.
I receive.
I receive.
I receive.
This blessing.
This blessing.
I thank you, Lord.
I thank you, Lord.
That I have the opportunity.
That I have the opportunity.
To give.
To give.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Now this is, I love that song. But this is what I've been told to do in the Holy Spirit tonight. And is according to scripture of Apostle Paul, who said, I perceive. Tonight I'm going to tell you what I sense in my spirit. Now this is beyond perception. This is maybe the gifts of discernment, or the gift of wisdom, or the gift of knowledge. Just asking God, God, what are you going to do? And kind of comes to me and forms, in my mind. And you know, the Holy Spirit is, but every one of you, I just want you to get ready to receive, because there's some things that I can't reveal, probably won't reveal, because it's impossible with this many people. But this is only to help you with your faith. This keeps going in my mind, and there are either young people or there are mature people that you are specifically going into. I think Charisse referred to it. You're going into financial consulting. You feel like you have the gift to help people make money, or you are going to maybe a banker, be a banker, or you're, anyway, it has to do with finances, and you've been feeling this. Stand up. You've been feeling this. I feel like this is what I'm going to go into, financial callings. I'm going to go into stockbroker. I don't have all the names, but you feel that it's a ministry, it's a gift, and you're learning about it. And the Lord has spoken to me tonight For everyone that's standing, God is going to put an anointing upon you. I don't know who you are. God's going to put an anointing upon you. And I don't want to know the avenues other than, you know, and there are people standing. Listen to me. Listen to what I'm saying. Because there are going to be several people tonight, you're going to miss out on this. You're ashamed to stand. Don't be ashamed to stand. This is probably the biggest opportunity of your lifetime, that you're going to go into this field. And I encourage you not to. Don't be reserved. Don't worry about what anybody thinks. You may be nothing now. You may not know nothing. But God, you feel this thing on you. And I just can't get it off. I just all night long, God has been saying, I want you to announce this, because I'm going to put a special anointing upon these people. And your walk and your favor, many things are going to happen to you. And not only are you going to help people, but you're going to be able to, I don't have all the words adequately to say. Everybody say, in the name of Jesus.
The name of Jesus.
Everybody that's standing. For this cause. Will be blessed. From this day forward. And this is a sign to you. That God. Is interested. In your calling.
Your gift.
Let the anointing come upon you now.
Let the anointing come upon you now.
The gifts, power. Somebody give a great big hand clap. God has just done that. I wanted to do that. You may be seated, for you that are standing. So there's something else. I have no idea. Honest, I have no idea. I don't go through the green cards and figure, I'll see who's got this, who's got this. So I don't know. But I want to say that you're in the audience tonight, and God, I just sense this, and not perceive it, but it's a gift of wisdom here, or gift of knowledge. God's going to heal your liver. You have a liver problem, or you have liver issues. And I want you to stand, whoever you are. I can't. Who are you? There you are. In the balcony. There you are. And let me teach you something. I don't want you to think, for you that are standing and for everybody sitting down, well, that's easy to do, Pastor. Anybody could say, got liver problem. That's an easy deal. You just pull something out of the air. Well, let me just say this. Even if I pulled it out of the air and I speak it with my faith, I still am in the boundaries of a miracle from God. So I want to talk to the demon that's talking to me right now. You're giving me mind messages. Let me tell you something, demon. You demon in the mind that's playing with me, I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. You have no authority to play mind games with me. Go to hell in the name of Jesus. Leave with the blood of Jesus. Get out. Don't play mind games with me. Just because you've been hanging with BB brains and no spirituality, and you've been in a babbling society, a godless society, and you try to figure out that this is manipulation. No. No devil wants anybody to be healed. And I'm claiming that every one of you that are standing, God's going to do a miracle in the name of Jesus Christ. Somebody shout, in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
How many want everybody here that's standing to be healed? How many? Clap your hands. How many? How many want to be healed? All of you that are standing. All of you that are standing. You will be healed. You will be healed. You may be seated. Amen. I pray for all valves of all hearts, that all cholesterol be gone in the name of Jesus, and that valves of blood will run into the hearts effectively. I speak that over you. I'm going to speak something that I've never, I'm going to speak something from now to the 31st of May. I'm going to do something I've never done, I'm thinking, in my entire ministry, and I am going to pray and speak it over you, that you're going to laugh more. I said, you're going to laugh more. You're going to be happier than you have ever been. From now to the 31st of May, until people think you're drunk. You may be seated. Let me tell you what's going to happen. I'm almost done. I'm going to release this thing here. Let me tell you what's going to happen. You're going to be with your family, and all of a sudden, you're going to start laughing. What are you laughing about? I just thought of that. And then the other table's going to laugh. Because God, the Bible says, a merry heart bringeth medicine. And I am praying that now to May 31st, happy days, laughing days, peaceful days, good days. I don't know about you, but I want to laugh. I want to enjoy. I want to be the joy of the Lord. Amen. I don't think I've ever prayed that first before, but I prayed that. Thank you, Jesus. So now is what I'm bringing everybody to, and I want you to take your faith, everybody, and everybody in this room. I don't know what you're believing for. Some, God knows, that's the most important thing. But I perceive that probably 90% or 100% of you wonderful, precious people are going to receive this tonight. And I mean, you've already had some miracles, but there is, I don't know if you heard me, but after the 8:30 service Sunday morning, Prophet Keelan is in India. He would have been here tonight, but he's in India, and he's coming to be a resident on our pastoral staff. He's the most powerful prophet. He prays about 4 or 5 hours a day. He's from India. Some of you know him. I've just never seen anybody like him. And believe it or not, we in the future are going to, with our university, have a prophet of school, school of prophets, so that we can understand better the gifts of the Spirit. But He don't never call me and never say anything. But after the 8:30 service, he called me from India. And he said, I saw angels come into the church. And he said, it is the beginning of great amounts of prosperity. And it's going to go from the head down to the body. And he mentioned great, wonderful things that were going to happen to you. And today about 5 o'clock, now that was Sunday, and he said there was angels on this platform, and he could see. I don't know if he was watching the service or praying, whatever. But I want to tell you that his prophecies have, even today, came to pass. And that means, he said, from the head down is going to happen. So there's going to be financial, there's going to be favor, there's going to be doors open, there's going to be healings, there's going to be deliverances. Okay, this is it. This is it. Whatever it is, I'm going to call out the name of Jesus, and I'm going to shout as loud as I can over this microphone, and I'm going to shout, stand. When I shout, stand, because I perceive and believe that everyone here, not just some of you, but all of you, that whatever your need is, I'm going to tell you to stand. I'm going to shout it just like Paul did. When you stand to your feet, it's going to hit you just like that. And God is going to perform something, whether it be tomorrow, the next few weeks. Something is going to be released. For I perceive that all of you came tonight expecting something to happen from God. When you get to your feet, you got to be like the man who never walked. No doubt the Bible said he shouted and everybody saw the miracle. When I tell you with the authority of the name of Jesus to come to your feet and I shout that word, you come to your feet and say, it's mine, I receive it. It is done in my life. Don't worry how it is going to take place. Let God do that. Walk out of here with so much victory. I perceive in the balcony, and over here in this section, and over here in this section, and that section, and everyone that's watching me, and this section, and this section, and that section, and that section, and that section, and that section, and everybody on this platform, I perceive in the name of Jesus, stand. Come on, tell God, I believe it. Oh, it's going to be wonderful how you're going to turn it out. It's mine. All of you watching me, it's yours right now. Turn to 5 people and say, I got it. Turn to the other five people and say, you're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed. Oh man, go out of here with a miracle tonight. God bless you. See you Sunday.
God's presence was surely in the house tonight. Lives were changed. People were healed. Delivery happened. Provision happened. I'm so thankful that God is faithful to meet us in His place, in His sanctuary. Thank you for joining us tonight. See you this weekend, Sunday, 8:30, 10:30, 12:30, where God will continue to move and meet us in His sanctuary. See you this weekend.